I mean, I think it's just giving them a voice and letting them know they have a voice right now. Like, you don't have to wait. Like I was saying before, like I was waiting to graduate, to land a job. Like, you don't have to wait for anything.
What's going on? You're listening to episode 73 of the Perspective Podcast, and I'm your host, Scotty Russell, the Perspective Collective. This show is about carving out time to build something for yourself and about being open to seeing things from a different perspective. I want to share what is and isn't working for me, along with sharing my guest point of view. As you know, Creative South starts tomorrow, and I want to quickly note that my Creative South two-part workshop on crafting and delivering a killer talk is tomorrow morning and in the afternoon, and we still have a few seats left you can buy online at creativesouth.com or at the registration table. And just so you know a little bit more about this, this will be the last time I plug this. This workshop is going to give you the process and formula to break down your main message and deliver a heater with confidence. You'll even get a chance to get a feel for the big stage as the second part of the conference is held in the historic Springer Opera House. So get your tickets online today. Again, at creativesouth.com or come to the registration table early as part one of the workshop is from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. And regardless if you're at the workshop, make sure you come and find me and say what's up. Let's get a drink. Let's get a slice. I usually have shit to hand out to people, so make sure you introduce yourself if we don't know each other yet. All right, so what if I told you that you had the ability to contribute to something bigger than yourself? What if I convinced you that you had the ability to leave your mark and impact on our future? Someone who is living life to their full potential and helping others reach theirs is my man Jamal Collins, aka Jay Working out of Cleveland, Ohio. Jamal uses his ambition and curiosity to constantly reinvent himself to the point that he now pours his wealth of knowledge of design, entrepreneurship, social media, and character building into the youth of Cleveland. He serves as an educator, a mentor, a consultant, and most importantly, a role model to our future generation who often lacks encouraging influences around him. Jamal is the real deal, and the things he teaches can inspire not only the youth, but inspire people like you at any stage of your life or whatever stage of your creative career that you're on. You know, and he wants to help you as well as the kids become creative free thinkers and make something happen in your life. I'm stoked to bring you his story, as his mission is something I can totally stand behind. You can find the show notes to this episode at perspective-collective.com/73. And if you think someone can find value in this episode, please give it a share on social media. It's because of your word of mouth that the show keeps growing, and you know I love you for it. Finally, if you catch some inspiration from the show, create some artwork and tag me on Instagram. I'll give it a share where I post each week's episode artwork at Perspective Podcast. And I have a massive backlog right now because you guys keep creating, you keep tagging, and I got to get my ass on to sharing. So I appreciate you. Let's get into the show. Ladies and gentlemen, today I'm chopping it up with Jamal Collins, aka Jay Working. And Jamal and I met and shared the stage at WMC Fest back in August. And his story and what he's doing for the younger generations was incredibly inspiring. And that's why he's here today on the show. So, Jamal, thanks for joining us, man. How's life, my friend?
Thank you. Thank you. I'm blessed. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to know you too, Scotty.
Yeah, that's awesome. We vibe really well. You were recently just on Diane's show, right? Design Recharge?
Yep.
How did that go? Let's just talk about right away. Was it a workshop that you held?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So Spark 216 was a chance to expose the youth and parents to the design and the design disciplines. So and that's touched every discipline from architecture, photography, design thinking, graphic design, illustrations. And what's so awesome about it is that we had two design leaders for each table that volunteered their time on a Saturday from 1 to 5 to get with the youth. And this was all hands-on thinking, using personas and Legos and some basic cameras, but not a lot of tech with this. So we also handed them some books that had different salaries and different schools and just like a snapshot of what it could be like if you wanted to be into architecture. So I got with four other designers, me, Jacinda Walker, Jamel Wilkerson, and a guy named Robert Gatewood. And it was cool. So it was at this place called Gamer Haven. And Gamer Haven is like a coffee shop slash video game working space. So he has all kind of video games there. You just walk up to the counter and say, I want Mortal Kombat. He hands it to you and you play all day.
That's awesome. And I definitely want to dive deeper into about this mission of working with the youth too. But I just wanted to catch people up to speed of just one of the things you're doing right off the bat that's helping the youth. But I guess just starting off, can you give us a brief Wikipedia page summary about yourself, kind of maybe a little bit about your background and what you actually do today?
First of all, I'm a son. I'm a father. I'm a husband. I'm a brother. I'm a cousin to some. And I'm a designer. So, and that it hits all disciplines. So that's photography, that's video, that's web, that's graphic design, that's illustration. And next off, I'm slash educator. So, and the most part about the education part is that I'm a mentor. So I'm more of a mentor than the education. I kind of use that education as a tool to mentor the youth, to get them to thinking on the right page. So I started an after-school program called Creative Kids, and I teach them the basics of and the fundamentals of graphic design. And I use Photoshop and illustrations to do Illustrator to do that. I work as a consultant for the most part. So I hit different locations. I have partnerships with the Boys and Girls Club. I have a partnership with the schools and any type of place where I can get in and show the youth. So
that's awesome, man. I commend you for all of that, dude. So kind of like your backstory, what's been the crooked path, you know, to discovering design, and where did your obsession with Photoshop spark from? Because in the show notes, I definitely want to share some of your speed Photoshop work. Because it's just wild, you know, but that's what I've known you for outside of the work you do with the youth was just your Photoshop skills on top of your video. But what led you into getting into design and where did this Photoshop obsession spark from?
I mean, I want to say like my upbringing, like I have very involved parents. I was fortunate to have grandparents on both sides. My mother and father were still together. And my grandmother and grandfather on both sides was also together, married. So that foundation helped me navigate through school and navigate past drugs and violence and all the kind of things that kind of plagued my community as I was growing up. So I kind of got into some trouble here and there. But for the most part, I was able to make the right moves. I had a friend who graduated from... he graduated like 2 years before me. He went to OU. So he told me to come down there, and that was kind of like my exposure. So I want to say just I was just lucky on some parts, you know what I'm saying? Because I was kind of didn't get a lot of exposure in school. So that was kind of the problem. I talk about it all the time. We had commercial arts. They was doing some cool stuff, but you needed good grades to get in there. No one from commercial arts came down there to talk to me, to recruit me, to tell me what my options was. Oh, you can't get in there. Let's get this guy in here. Stuff that I do now. So this is kind of like the driving force of what I do, why I do it. So I went to Akron U. It was kind of a cool time because it wasn't no internet. It wasn't no computers yet. So I really don't tell the story a lot, but I was going to school to be pre-med. Not
really?
Pre-med. Not pre-med, a lawyer. So I was taking law classes because I wanted to be a lawyer. And I told somebody that when I get my law degree, I'm going to have my own art studio. So somebody's like, why don't you just go into art? So,
dang, so that's how it started.
Yeah. So I looked into the art program, and they had something called graphic design. I didn't know what the hell it was. It sounded cooler than being an illustrator at the time. You know, it's like starving artists. Mm-hmm. We don't know nothing about this type of we don't know nothing about art at this time because this is 90s. This is before the computer. It wasn't even no internet in the art lab at the time. I took graphic design, and then we had a wave of technology. I fell in love with technology. I fell in love with Photoshop.
What were some of the first programs you were using? Were you using like Quark and all that stuff back in the day? Or
Corel Draw,
Corel Draw?
Remember Freehand?
Yeah, that was like early. It was on the outskirts of leaving before I got it. I had to like just dabble in it before I got into Illustrator. So
yeah. I got lucky. I got my first computer when I was 25. So I was like around 95. I got a Performer. It had a video capture card. The only issue was that we didn't have Google, so I couldn't just type in like clouds and clouds and lightning and fire and get all these images for free. We needed a scanner, and at the time, scanners was $1,000. I was scanning books, but I wanted to get myself in the computer so I can like have myself loading and, you know, do some designs with myself. So that was like one of my main things that I was kind of interested in.
And you just got more obsessed with Photoshop along the way?
Yeah. I was one of the only guys at home that had a computer at the time. Cause it's like, I had internet, I had dial up at home. I was hooking up my VCR to my computer cause I had a video capture card and I was grabbing images off of VCR tapes.
Did you pick up some type of freelancer stuff around then, or like gig posters or any type of flyers, or like, were you doing any of that? Cause you were the only one?
Yeah, no. Now at the time I ain't really know how to know how. You know, it was so crazy that we was renting our homes all at the time. Like, we getting student loans, we blowing our money. Like, we really didn't have no type of person who came back and said, like, you guys should buy a house with this money. You know, I'm touching probably $10,000 a semester, something crazy like that. Like, and I think I was just so focused on getting a degree. That was it. Like, we didn't know nothing about no side hustle. I mean, I had some friends hustling some other stuff, but not.
Well, I think that's good, because eventually you shifted your attention, you know, building, getting a degree and everything, but now you shifted your attention to working with the youth. And, you know, how did that come about, and why is giving back to your community so important to you? Because honestly, that's the person I see outside the Photoshop. That's the bigger picture that I see that I can get behind.
Well, the thing was happening is that I was just trying to follow the rules of the status quo, was degree, job, work your way up the ladder, retire. And it just wasn't working out. Like, the economy tanked. Graphic design is getting outsourced at a rapid rate. My value was going down, so I was forced out of corporate. I was no longer being able, and it was a lot of frustration in that, because I was at a top accounting firm, PricewaterhouseCoopers, for 10 years. So I'm used to being somewhere comfortable. I want to show that I can stay at a company and I can be underneath this big name. And, you know, you can hand me a manual and I can take orders and I can follow the instructions on what you tell me.
Production artists, basically.
Exactly. And I was, I had to figure out something. I had to reinvent myself. And I just was taking anything, and I took something that was completely out of my comfort zone. So I think, like, each time from me going into the teaching route, I'm completely going outside my comfort zone. And I want to say something as simple as face painting. Like, man, I'm nervous to even do this. So, you know, I just got comfortable being uncomfortable all the time, because I'm in, like, the worst neighborhood possible. Second day I was working, and plus I wasn't making top dollar. I'm working part-time. This isn't like the highest paying job. It's after school. Second day at work, they stole my car. So now I had to get through that hump of walking to work, saving up my money to buy another car, because, you know, I got a family to support. My kids are homeschooled. So I'm the breadwinner at some point of the game. So, it was crazy.
Well, and what were you doing for the after school stuff? Were you teaching, or?
Yeah, I just came in as an art teacher. So that's painting, ceramics,
yeah,
and drawing. But the area is wasn't the best managed area, and a lot of them had like some hunger issues. They dealing with gangs. You know, they dealing with a lot of the outside of what they're dealing with in school, bullying. It's a lot of stuff going on. So when they come into the, you know, after school program, they just want to run around and play basketball for the most part. And I guess I want to say that, I'm not going to say that drawing wouldn't stimulate them to a certain point, but you would have to be like a special creative kid like me or you to really enjoy going in there drawing. It's not really going to grab a guy who's just want to play basketball all day. So I think the design part aspect of it, Photoshop, you know, really painting a picture of this can be more than just drawing, and, you know, you could really take it to another level. If, you know, so I saw some consultants coming in doing specialized work, and I seen some computers at the main Boys and Girls Club, and I presented the idea, like, let me go come in and do some specialized work. They went for it. I started, you know, real small at one location, and then it grew to like 7.
Wow. So you went from corporate life doing graphic design to becoming an art teacher to kind of creating and taking the initiative and creating your own role as a consultant and using computers and starting after school programs for kids.
And then it's what's crazy is like, I'm not a teacher by trade, Scotty. So I had to teach myself how to write curriculums, how to engage the youth, how to manage a classroom. So this is all hands-on work and trying to figure out how to market myself at the same time. And, you know, I started videotaping my class. And then that's when I could really see and really perfect, you know, my delivery and my classroom management. And I saw something. I showed the connection with me and the youth, and I showed and I kind of saw that they needed more than just a design. They needed a way of thinking about entrepreneurship, thinking about their grades, being responsible, how to act at home. So this is the things that I saw, and I was like, you know, I felt better about the things that I was doing because I might go through a whole day without talking about Photoshop and we just working on character. And I'm like, damn, I ain't teach them anything about design. And I'm like, man, I'm messing up. But when I looked at it, like, no, they, you know, it's just me in there and whatever I feel like they need is more important than learning the tools of the pen tool at that time.
That's awesome. So then this is kind of a two-part question then. So what is your mission right now? And then from there, how were you able to find your style and voice within design and combine your skills of imagery and just teaching hands-on, I guess, complement your mission?
I think my mission right now is get more parent involvement. I got the youth, but I don't know if their parents are, you know, I want the parents to invest in these guys and stop buying tennis shoes if they can, stop buying Xboxes and buy computers and laptops and cameras and microphones like we're talking about. So my mission is really to spread the, you know, the word with the youth and engage as many kids as possible and to use, you know, the people I know and the connections I know and to have the youth have a connection. So if I'm 12 and I'm working on some lettering and I want to call you up, then I should be able to call you up. And, you know, it's like, you know, being able to connect these guys with some older seasoned veterans and get them the points that they need to help them navigate, man. So it's like less time on figuring out their route and the ways that what's going on. Like, even if you sit and talk to, you know, paint a picture with some parents, you know, and just say, look, this is what I'm doing. This is how I'm doing it. Like, I don't hold back when I talk to them. I talk about pricing. I talk about difficulties and client work. Like, I paint a picture for them so they know exactly what they're getting into.
Well, then how did you bring in like the whole social media aspect of things? Because you said you would record your classes, but I've seen you then take footage from your classes and do like time lapse and like weave in some type of audio with it and compile videos because you've had some heavy hitter videos on YouTube, I believe. I saw one especially like Cleveland based that I also link up in the show notes. But how did you find your style and your voice with design? Because yes, you're teaching these kids, but you're also repurposing what you're doing with these kids and making it into social media worthy posting to help spread your, you know, awareness and your mission. Now, how'd you get into doing that?
All right. So, you know, like I started before, like I started in the 90s. So I beta tested all of these programs. So I had the first Premiere. So I was always like above and beyond what I was supposed to be doing at the accounting firm. I was designing web pages. So we was always like me and my other little friends in the design. We always had our eyes to, you know, the future. So we're looking at, oh, website is a new thing. We got to get learn this.
Ahead of the curve, yeah.
Yeah, ahead of the curve. So MP3s, this is new. I was making DVDs. So I was always ahead of that. And I was always trying to, I always had a portfolio. I was always kind of looking for work. I was trying to migrate into doing web design. So I had, you know, I had a website full of websites I was doing because I knew you could make a lot of money being a web designer, still can. So I'm learning code, trying to learn PHP. So I've always been ambitious about learning and creating stuff so people could see it. So it was just me just kind of, you know, it's kind of almost like second nature's a part of my DNA. I think I just picked it up. I think I just turned it up a little bit more. So I was like, the missing piece with designers is that we don't get a real good understanding of marketing. It's two different departments when I graduated. It may be more more intertwined right now, but you know, when I was growing up, I mean, when I graduated, marketing was a whole nother department. So they didn't teach us how to market and sell ourselves. They just showed us how to make a good portfolio to get a job. The rest was on us.
True. So is that what you are now kind of building in, not only the artist, the creative switch or the hat, but also blending in that business hat too, learning both of them?
Yeah, I think you have to. I think it might have not been practical back in 2097, but now in 2018, it is, because of, you know, YouTube and the social networks. We didn't have all this stuff. Like, I was doing an event before Facebook, and I had just, me and my friend was just doing flyers, and we put a big banner on the bus circulating downtown, and we really didn't get no traction. So it was like, wasn't no analytics. And so now we have all this stuff that is easier. Like, if I wanted to get in contact with an executive, I had to get to a secretary. I'm sending email, snail mail. Like, now you can just go right into Scotty's inbox and say, hey, Scotty, look at these sketches. You're going to look at them. So, you know, now it's super practical for these guys to really use all these resources and be able to look up some salaries, look up, you know, what's the market looking like somewhere else, or look up somebody their age doing something, like, and get motivation and inspiration from that.
How do you help provide these kids autonomy and turn them into creative free thinkers? I guess, can you define what you mean by that? Because I know that's kind of a steady thing that you like to talk about in a lot of your content.
I mean, I think it's just giving them a voice and letting them know they have a voice right now. Like, you don't have to wait. Like I was saying before, like I was waiting to graduate to land a job. Like, you don't have to wait for anything. By the time these guys graduate, that's 4 or 5 years down the road of content that we could have. So it's like, you know, telling a story and saying that, I think telling a story and letting them know that everybody is unique. And I think the most important thing to tell them is, like, you know, everybody has the same equal playing field, because you have a brain. Einstein had the same brain you had. So it's really no difference between you and a genius. Like, it's just a whole mindset type of thing. So I'm trying to get them to think like, you know, you have the power to do whatever you want at 14. Like, it's you know, I know some little 14-year-old guys is crushing. And I want to say, like, if you born in America, you probably heard this before, you won a lottery. I mean, the odds of you could have been, you know, handicapped, born in a third world country. It's going to be tougher for you. These guys got parents, houses, computers at home already. They just walking past them. Or, you know, they have access to me and they only do it when they see me. So the days I'm not there, they walking past the computers, not even looking at them. So it's like, you know, I want them to use their mind and think, man. That's the most important thing I want.
What is so funny is that what you're doing and what you're preaching at such a young age for this is still something that a lot of people in my audience struggle with, is waiting for that permission, or, like, even at my age, you know, waiting for permission and not realizing you have a voice, that your work is unique. So actually what you're teaching these kids are something that would resonate with a lot of other people. I don't know if you've ever seen it that way, but a lot of adults and people coming right out of college, they need to hear this same stuff. It would have benefited them to hear it when they were in middle school.
Yeah, exactly. I was just reading something yesterday, and it was talking about, it made an analogy of how to catch a fox. So, you know, I guess foxes are hard to catch. So they kind of built like a little gate around some food. He goes in, he eats the food, and he leaves out. And then they put some more food in there, and they make the gate a little bigger. So then he goes in there, and he eats again. He comes out. The third time he goes in there, the gate is way bigger. He's got way more space. And they just closed the door on them. So the analogy, what they were making, was that the industrial industry did the same thing to us. They got us locked in, comfortable, and we don't know to break out.
Yeah, no, that's extremely true. Actually, I was having a conversation with that work today, just like how a lot of the education system is still tied to, like, the Industrial Revolution, when they were just forcing us to be factory workers and stuff like that.
The thing is like, the factory is done, but the cubicles is still like the factory.
Exactly.
And I let them know, like, you know, you might have seen maybe a video. I said, you know why they want you to sit here for a long time? So they're like, why? because they want you to sit in a factory for a long time. You know, they need to make the connection. I think, like, I was kind of talking about the secrets of war, and, like, I mean, they just need more, man. And parents need to really invest in them to know, to let them know, like, what's going on. Like, I think, to me, and my parents was working, man. And, you know, I flunked the second grade. I had issues with it. And I feel like that my parents should have just told me, like, this is kind of some of the stuff that you're going to have to deal with. I think it lessens the sting. Like, you know, even like my professor saying, look, you know, you're going into a dominantly white field of graphic design. It's not a whole lot of y'all. You need to cater your portfolio towards that industry. So, you know, so you can get in there. Like, you know, so life is about following, being, you know, we're a bunch of followers, and we kind of scared to break the mold and come out and say, look, this is who I really am. You know, I have a beard, you know, I talk like a certain way. Like, you know, we kind of, you know, it's okay to look up to other people, but you got to understand, like, he's who he is and I'm who I am. I could never be an Elon Musk or, you know, but I could look up to him and probably get some gold nuggets from him. But at the same time, I need to form who Jamal is, who Jay working is.
That's gold, man. That's absolute gold. Don't ever apologize, because a lot of things we suffer or struggle with is showing our true selves on a daily as well as in our work. I know for me, it was hard for a long time. I was scared to be who Scotty was. I swear I'm very loud sometimes. You know, I can go on tangents and I'm just extremely extroverted. But I felt so I had to refine myself and filter myself for the longest time. And now I'm learning to accept who I am and show myself in my work. And I think that's hard for a lot of people, especially like when we were younger, nobody ever told me that I could be like that way. I thought I was always playing follow the leader.
Exactly.
Well, then how do you challenge kids to think about how they're going to add value and give back to the community? Because I believe it was a video I heard you say that in or something. And that kind of just blew me away, because I'm challenging, you know, people in my audience and my age, you know, how are you giving value back to the community in order to build your audience? But you're challenging them way younger. Like, nobody ever asked me that.
One of my bullet points that I want to let them know is like, the days of sending off a resume and falling in line, like we're talking about, is far in between. And to stand out, they have to have their own type of voice. They have to build content right now. They should be on LinkedIn right now. They should be doing a lot of stuff and not waiting to, you know, like we said, I guess that's the thing, waiting to graduate to make an impact. Like, they could serve their community now and do some work now. And you know, because I tell them they could work for me. Like, if you learn, you're old enough to teach the younger guys this Photoshop, and I'll hire you to do that. You know, the work that comes in, like, I'm going to pass it to them. So it's just really trying to build a community, because that's what we are, Scotty. We're a community, and we need to always be connected to the youth and make them feel like they're at home, man. I felt like I was kind of, like, figuring this out. Like, I'm about to be 48. I'm just now figuring it out, like, why can't I just give like all my years of experience and give it to them and let them figure it out? So it's like, you know, it's a bunch of stuff that hasn't been invented yet. It's Ubers that need to be invented. It's Airbnbs that haven't been invented yet. And these are the guys who are going to do it. But if they don't have the knowledge and the capacity to come in and understand, like, I need to get all this content in my brain to execute to have a spark of an idea and execute on that idea, and they're not going to do it. So it's like, you know, getting them used to thinking like, you have to read, you have to put as much information in that well as possible, because if you don't, you're not going to spark any idea. You're kind of a consumer. Like, the problem is they're consuming, like, you're taking in all this music. How are you going to have a spark of an idea if you're just congesting what somebody else is doing, you know, and the social networks and all of that stuff? Like, it's feedback loops, dopamine rushes on this stuff, and it can kind of hypnotize these guys into just being consumers. But, you know, when I tell them I don't look at the Cavs games, I'm not listening to music a lot. I'm reading like, why? They want to understand why. So it's like, you know, really getting them to understand, like, it's really, you know, a science and the mathematics on, you know, kind of behind a lot of this stuff on, you know, the creative thinkers who's going to really crush it and maximize their thought capacity and good grades. Like, I was telling the kid in the video, like, it's a science to getting good grades. It's ways to hack reading the book Maybe you read the table of contents and get the takeaways out of the book, and now you understand it. The teachers don't understand. They want them to read it from front to back. He's not going to read it from front to back. Like, okay, Scotty, I got a beautiful story. I told this on Diane. I got to tell you, too.
Yeah, please.
I got a guy named Elijah, and he's like 12 or 13. This guy is a perfect designer. I mean, he's like, he's one of my best guys. He's just started with me, and he can't spell that good. You know, and I know teachers would frown on him and probably kick him out of my program or hold him back so he needs to work on his spelling. But this guy is on another level when it comes to designs. So I got two guys in there. I got Elijah and I got another student in there. And usually I give them 5 or 6 steps to take before they, you know, can run off on their own. This is what I want from you guys. I got one student does the 6 steps and then he leaves. Elijah looks at me like, why is he leaving? Why does he continue to do stuff? I'm like, I don't know. Maybe he has something else to do. This guy keeps working and keeps coming out. He doesn't want to leave. So when I see that type of thing, because I have like tons of them, they do the manual that I give them. Then they run off. This guy's staying in, but his grades, I don't know how his grades are, but his spelling is not up to the level that it should be at his age. But design wise, he's a genius. So I thought that was kind of unique when I think about, you know, the latest things I've been doing. When I think about him, it's kind of like a unique case because he's a designer, and I'm sure somebody would frown on him because his spelling ain't up to his grade level.
What I really like, though, is that you're finding the ones that do shine and you probably invest a little bit more in them. Like, you give it to all of them, but you find the ones that are truly latched on, and, you know, and those could be the future ones that are making a big play, are making a big splash, and then passing it on to the next people. And I think that's because I come from a coaching background. So when I graduated college, I was still coaching. I went back to my alma mater and was coaching high school football, specifically varsity, but was working with the younger freshmen and sophomores at the same time as well. And, you know, some of them needed it more because they came from households that maybe didn't have electricity. We'd have to pick them up early from a different house and take them home to a different house at times. They didn't have money for camps and everything like that. They came from troubled backgrounds, but it's the ones that we invested in, those that are now in college and have great jobs and, you know, kicking ass. It was larger than football, which what you're doing is larger than just design.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. You nailed it. Yeah.
Yeah. You're creating something that's bigger than all of it, but the main focus is just showing these kids that, you know, a little bit of creativity and some effort and some character can spark a whole long time of success. And that's awesome, man.
Yeah. Thank you. I mean, my fear is that I know that it's going to be tough finding a job. Like, I talk to college students and say, it was about 20 students in this classroom who graduated last year. And it's going to be 20 students behind y'all coming. So how are you going to make a change and show somebody who you are and stand out amongst the crowd and find some work? Because it is no work, I feel. Like, you know, you got to create your own job and, you know, kind of be unique and say, instead of sending Scotty a resume, I'm going to have lunch with him and tell him, like, I researched everything about what you're doing, about the company, and this is how I'm going to make a change. That's going to, you know, you have to have these type of ideas, like I said.
That's awesome. I had the Chutzpah twins on recently, and they're going to be at Creative Style too, and we'll talk about that with you. The Chutzpah twins, they talked about how they couldn't land a job because they didn't have formal education. So what they did was go out and hire themselves and started creating those personal projects that ended up landing them the work. So I feel like you're teaching these youth to hire themselves right now.
And the parents too. The parents need to involve, get really involved and almost be a manager for the kids. The parents should be taking the kids to Southeast by Southwest, the design edition. It should be taking them to, yeah, you know, he's heavy into shoes. They should be shooting to Oregon with their kid. Like, here's the sketches. How can we get in here? Like, this is the necessary stuff that's going to have to happen to really, you know, it's the foundation, man. The more you have, and that's, you know, connecting with us is building that foundation too. So, you know, it's about exposure because the parents don't know what the kids don't know, some of them. So that's what that's about.
Yeah, for sure, man. Well, I think this last question before we get in rapid fire mode, I think this one applies not only to you speaking to the youth, but you speaking to my audience, because I think this is something many of us struggle as creatives is, what's one piece of advice you give to someone at any stage of creative in their creative path who struggles starting or sticking with it?
I would say, Come out your comfort zone. Be curious. Really, the advice is really, man, just do some work, do some things. Like, I give a lot of people advice and they really never do it. Like, you should screen capture anybody. Like, you should really take in as much info as possible. So a little less TV, a little less radio, and start looking towards people who really, you really feel like can really inspire you and see what their practices are. You know, if you really have, you want to be an Elon Musk, then you should know his morning practices. So that's my advice, is really just to go out and network too. I think that's the most important one too. Network.
I like that.
Networking is really vital, because I was doing a lot of legwork. So I know all the photographers. I know people at the art museums. I know writers. I know everybody, because I go out a lot at these events. So any young guys who, you know, had a capacity to drive and go to events, art shows, they should be there. I've been in spots where I didn't know anybody, and I'm like a fly on the wall. It's uncomfortable. And after a while, you just start meeting people. I think it's just a natural process. Like, you know, I used to go to Weapons of Mass Creation. I didn't know anybody. I didn't know Mike Jones, and I ain't know all these guys. I was walking up to him and say, hey, I'm Jamal, I'm Jay Working, I love your work, blah, 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 blah.
And now you're speaking at one last year, now you're speaking at Creative South this year.
Yeah, exactly. That's how it works.
Yeah, it just pays off getting uncomfortable.
Yes.
All right, rapid fire questions. If you were on death row, what would your last slice of pizza be?
I got something called, we had this place called Bogo's, and we had something called French Quarter, and the French Quarter got chicken sausages and shrimp on it, and black beans on it with Crayola sauce. So that'd be my one, French Quarter.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. And that's in Cleveland?
Yeah, it's called Bogo. It's an award-winning pizza spot.
Script serif or sans serif?
I want to say script, because that's the one I've been using the most.
Awesome. Yeah, I always see you using like these fancy serifs on your work. So I wasn't expecting script. All right, what's your favorite typeface?
Favorite typeface, the one I use the most. Let me see. It's called Boston Trunk Style. I don't know how I landed. Yeah, Boston Trunk Style.
Boston Trunk Style.
Kind of paid for that one, too. I kind of saw it. It's kind of you see it on all of my work. Yeah, that's my favorite.
All right. How do you unplug from work to recharge the creative juices? Or what do you consume for entertainment?
Entertainment. Now, I feel like I'm always working, Scotty. So I teach college. I teach photography and cinematography. So, you know, I like documentaries. So even when I'm looking at videos and movies and stuff, I'm trying to analyze the scenes and transitions.
All right. You can't shut it off.
I'm always like in a creative mode. I try to take Sunday off and just don't go anywhere. I run around all week.
Okay.
I'm averaging at least 2 meetings a week. People keep pulling me in for freelance work. I can't get away from that. And working with the youth, I'm working 4 locations, 4 jobs. So I teach college during the day. I'm after school with the Boys and Girls Club. I got a Saturday course. So Sunday is my wind down time.
All right, that works. Okay, this one caught my attention earlier. You say you're always looking for like what's next in the technology world, whether it was like Photoshop or whatever new things, coding, whatever it was. What's something new that's piquing your interest these days that you want to get into or learn and then teach?
Probably online learning, like being able to be a resource. So I'm kind of looking into being able to set up a website where you can tap in and get some courses. Yeah, online courses. Technology-wise, I'm looking at camera stuff all the time. So I'm really...
I don't know if it's like VR, AR, anything like that.
No, I'm like kind of looking at cameras and lenses and stuff. Like, I'm really fascinated with cinematography right now. So that's my thing. So if I, you know, could get some equipment and just, I kind of want to master Premiere. I'm okay with it, but I just want to take my videos up another notch. So the vlogs, yeah.
Awesome, awesome. What's coming up that people should look forward to?
Yeah, Creative South. I'm going to change up my keynotes. I think my last keynotes was kind of like, you know, my bio, a little bit about me. And I'm probably talk more about the shift of, you know, being Jamal Collins to Jay Working and what that feels like. And, you know, my goal at Creative South is, you know, hopefully I want to fill up, you know, people's notebooks and sketch pads with a lot of ideas and quotes and things like that. So.
Where can people go to find you online?
Jayworking.com, JAYWORKING. And I'm on the social networks underneath that same handle. So YouTube, Jay Working, Twitter, Jay Working, Jamal Collins at Facebook. Trying to take up at least 3 or 4 pages on Google if you type in Jay Working. Only got one for right now.
Hey, goals, man. Well, I got everything linked up in the show notes too. So, man, I sincerely appreciate you taking the time and sharing your story and sharing all the crazy, amazing things you're doing for the youth, man. We need more Jamal Collins in this world.
Thank you. Yes, we're going to spread the word, Scotty.
So there you have it, Jamal Collins, a.k.a. Jay Working. And I heard a lot of good things about Jamal leading up to when I met him at WMC Fest, August 2017. But actually getting to hear his story and seeing the impact that he's making in the community and just how loved he is in Cleveland right now, it blew me away. I have so much respect for this guy and what he's doing for our future generation. And we need more Jamal Collins in this world. So don't ever sit there thinking that you can't make an impact on something that's much greater than yourself, because Jamal Collins is living proof. And, you know, I think you have that potential as well, whether it's on the youth, whether it's on other creatives or in your community, whatever it is, you have that potential. And I think we owe it to the world, you know, to share that gift and to pour something positive into the community and do something good for other people. This week's dose of inspiration goes out to one of my newer homies, Josh Griggs of the lettering feature account Type Yeah on Instagram. And I love Josh because he also holds down a day job just like me. I believe in web design and UX UI design just like me. And he spends his time outside of work creating and plugging up and coming as well as well-known letters on his Type Yeah account. I think it's pretty cool how people use their platform to support others. And that's what I want to do with this platform. And I think you dig his account just like the other over 23,000 people as I record this do as well. So again, check that out over at Type Yeah on Instagram, and make sure you're using your hashtag and maybe you can also catch a feature. So keep up the good work, Josh. Good work, man. If you're enjoying what you hear and you want to support the growth of this show, I have a few ways you can make that happen. The first way is by becoming a backer at patreon.com/perspectivepodcast. Not only can you donate per episode with as little as your weekly cup of coffee, but I want to try and hook you up with some rewards as well, so it's a win-win. The second way to support the show is for you crypto junkies out there. In the show notes for each episode, I'll have addresses for Bitcoin, Ethereum, or Litecoin donations. If you want to go that route, that'd be swell. And finally, you can leave a ratings and review over on iTunes. It not only helps the show get discovered, but it gives me an opportunity to give you a nice little thank you plug, like this week's rating and review. And this one comes from Chris Von Bursk. What's up, Chris? And he titles this one, Must Listen Now. He states, man, Scotty is a great dude. Shucks. This podcast is so inspiring and entertaining. And Scotty has started bringing on some great guests that provide lots of value. The theme music and production value is great. Must listen. Thank you, Chris. I sincerely appreciate all of the comments, the likes, the encouragement you've sent me over the last 2 years that I can easily remember. So hopefully this is a nice little thank you plug back. Finally, if you're seeking like-minded individuals, you want to share your work, you want to get amazing feedback, you want to give feedback and just, again, become part of something that's just greater than yourself and build amazing relationships, then I think you should check out my Facebook community. It's growing, it's thriving, tons of interaction and engagement in there each day. It's so awesome to see, and I would love to have you a part of it. The only rule is no dickheads and no negativity. So if you want some community, check it out at Facebook at The Perspective-Collective. Us together, we make the collective, so it's not just about me. It's about all of us rising together, kicking ass and creating dope-ass work and building relationships. Finally, as I wrap things up, I want to give a huge shout-out to my homegirl, Anya Brennan, all the way from Ireland, for making this episode sound so good. And a huge thanks for Nick Jenkins of Bluka for all the dope theme music you hear on this show. Check him out at SoundCloud or on Instagram at Bluka. That's B-L-O-O-K-A-H. And as you finish off your week strong, I want to encourage you to keep showing up, keep putting in the work, and keep creating. You got this.